Welcome back to Wine and Wins. I'm your host, KP, a marine biologist with over a decade's worth of experience, mostly with marine mammals. Recently, we took a deeper dive into the hows and whys of marine mammal rescue. And here's a link to that video in case you missed it. In that video, we talked a bit about how government agencies like the DFO here in Canada or the NOAA back in the States make determinations about whether or not an animal is releasable. Unfortunately, in that video, we didn't really have time to dive into the parameters and guidelines that those agencies use to make those decisions. So we'll take a look at that today. But before we do, don't forget to like and subscribe. You can actually just hit the little button. There's a little wine glass down there. Just hit it. Just touch it. See what happens. The first thing to understand when it comes to marine mammal rescue is the priorities of these agencies. While the primary focus of the public tends to be individual animals, particularly if they're young or suffering, the government is almost solely focused on the health of the species out there in the ocean.
The only way to bridge the gap between these divided interests is for the laws and regulations to be black and white, with no gray areas or wiggle room for interpretation.
Number one, the release candidate must not pose a risk to wild populations, the environment, or to public safety. The biggest risk to wild populations is disease, especially given the close proximity to humans and other animals. And that's why these facilities are clean and sterile, just like a hospital. The animals are also constantly tested, quarantined, and even vaccinated. A prolonged stay at a rehabilitation facility may also lead to a habituation to human presence and food provision. This has the potential to decrease the animal's self-reliance and fear of humans, which could be dangerous for the animal and for people.
Come here,
Number two, the release candidate must be rehabilitated at an approved rehabilitation center. This criteria is primarily aimed at preventing attempts of wildlife rehabilitation and release by untrained individuals. The specific operation requirements for these facilities is extensive, and I won't bore you with the details. But I will post links in the descriptions below, if you're interested. The main thing to know is that attempting to rescue or rehabilitate an animal yourself poses risks to the animal, the environment, and of course yourself. The right thing to do if you see an animal in need is to stay back, keep people and pets away, and call the proper authorities. Number three. The release candidate must be healthy. This criteria refers to the animal's ability to survive in the wild. Rehabilitated animals need to demonstrate adequate foraging and social skills. This includes the ability to find, chase, and capture live prey. For sea otters, it also involves the ability to use tools to crack into their shelled prey. If the candidate is a pup, then it must be weaned and nutritionally independent in order to be considered a release candidate. In general, animals like seals have little to no guidance from their mothers after the nursing period. They're pretty much on their own after they're weaned, so there is little concern releasing them once they're healthy. Walrus calves, on the other hand, are non-releasable because of the extended period of maternal care and the extreme social nature of their species. The same is true for sea otter pups, who are dependent on their mothers for the first 6 months at least of their lives. These otters have so much to learn from their mothers that it is impossible to replicate it unless you have a surrogate mother otter. You can actually see the difference in otters like Joey and Taslina, who were separated from their mothers at a very young age.
Now we know! Now there's a scream in my face.
And animals like Quatsy, who spent several months with her mother.
How are you?
Quatsy already has the manners of an adult otter. She's really independent, quite content to do her own thing, and not nearly as needy as some other otters you might know. And Quatsy is one of those interesting cases, an example of a gray situation that had to be made black and white. Even though she has some of those survival skills to make it out in the ocean, the regulation is that she's under 6 months old when rescued. She's a non-releasable animal. But even though we always want to see these animals in their natural habitats, it is important to remember that she's now going to get to be an important ambassador for her species, raising awareness for an animal that needs our help. Hopefully this has given you a better idea of what it means to have a releasable or a non-releasable animal and the guidelines that go along towards making those decisions.
Water.
Make sure you drop a comment down below if you have any questions.
Good.
Don't forget to click on this little wine glass over here. Like and subscribe. And head over to my Twitch channel where we talk about all of these interesting topics live. And check out the descriptions down below where I've posted those government guidelines and cited sources.
Oh, that was rude.